Class, hello, it's Patrick. I really apologize for having to pull the plug on our Monday class. It was not expected. I just, as the day progressed, I didn't feel myself feeling that well, so I needed to kind of stop everything I was doing and kind of make that my priority, just getting better. But feeling a little bit better. But we're going to I'm going to schedule a class a little bit later this week. That's just going to be an open time where you can come and talk to me about the projects that you're working on. I'm obligated to, reschedule a class with you guys at sometime this week, and I think I'm going to do it either Thursday or Friday. I'll be posting something very soon about that. But I just wanted to talk about this first module's assignment, which is pretty, important to the next five modules that we're going to be doing, or all five modules. I doubt it's going to go beyond that. If it does, maybe it'll go one module beyond it, and then we can do something for the midterm. So we're creating concepts for a science fiction, or some type of imagined medical science canister container. And I've given you some reference information with this nuker grenade, just to help you with the pipeline, the process that you might take. I've asked you to avoid, military crates, things that don't have really interesting silhouettes. We're looking for negative space. We're looking for, compound surface directions. I'm looking for functionality, something that I can see, something that's recognizable, something that's well designed, and something that has a shape breakdown, right? We talked about this. Sometimes it's called primary, secondary, tertiary, quaternary, or whatever that would be in the fourth level of breakdown. But just categories of shape breakdowns that go into large, medium, small, and then fine in terms of your designing and your ability to do layout of shapes and the implementation of technology and things like that. You don't have to be a scientist or an engineer or anything like that, but it helps to do some research into, things that possess technology, and especially things that have external technology revealed to them, as well as, LED displays, that type of thing. I always suggest looking in the industrial sector, cryogenics, VR. In terms of graphics and things like that, just try to imagine yourself as someone who's designing something that is from a world that has a particular technology. Text and iconography is something we're going to be talking about. I'll be talking about that stuff in Photoshop at least, maybe even Illustrator, but just the idea of types of typefaces to avoid as opposed to ones that you would embrace and types of information that might be on this object. Right now it's the concept phase. So is this is one of those things where it's like I want to see as much as I can see to help get an idea of what you're thinking. I want to read as much as I can read to get an idea of what you're thinking. That leaves it up to you to really throw yourself into this and embrace an idea. And sometimes that can be the hardest thing in the world. The blank canvas can sometimes be the most intimidating thing in the world for an artist, because you just go, "What do I do? What do I do?" And I've given you some context. It's actually pretty constrained, in terms of the criteria that you need to work on. So you've got lots of options available, but you can drive down into each of these with your designs. So the submission, it's going to run the gamut. Images that might be 3D paintovers, modeling and sculpting. It might be blockouts, and then anything that's a Z tool, it might be something like that. If you've decided to dive into it a little bit more, in week two we're going to be doing, this revision of the concept and then diving into a lot of the high resolution, and continue that into the next module. So with that, I'm going to get started with each of your work, and I review things in the order in which they were submitted. Usually, to me, that's the fairest way to do it. And if everybody could watch this introduction, I'd appreciate it. And you can reach out to me with questions and comments. But as as I say in my course notes, the way I evaluate these things is I evaluate it, you get the grade, you move on to the next module, and you improve to improve your grade. I grade you where you are. There aren't, you know, we're not hitting the reset button on every assignment that you get to do, so you can, you know, improve it retroactively, basically. So, you know, I've been evaluating these. Some of these are absolutely fantastic. Some of these absolutely stink. And it's not a matter of the concept. It's a matter of the effort. And I'm going to let you know in no uncertain terms. We're in a 400-level class. You're getting ready to prepare yourself for, you know, some type of foray into the professional world if you haven't been already. And as the coaches say, it's go time. And so, you know, we need to hunker down with our effort and with our focus and with the questions that you ask me and with the energy that you bring to this class. So let's get started. Annabelle, hi, it's Patrick. Just give me a feedback. Apologize for not being able to make it to class on Monday and that this feedback is coming a little bit late, but hopefully this will get you a little bit more in shape with the way that your concept is coming along. Overall, let me read through what you got here. Warrior of Light, new invention is created to benefit the Warrior of Light. Durable container slips onto the belt. Allows the Warrior of Light to quickly swap in and out their current soul stones. So you can change out soul stones. Okay. Looks like you've got some concepts here. Let's talk about composition. I don't mind that you came up with, you know, this is, I think this would be an interesting thing that you might be able to put inside of the internal canister here. Let me use the Epic Pen for this. So one of the things that is probably good to talk about is the idea of asymmetrical balance and just altering it for compositional sake. I mean, you know, symmetry is all well and good. Excuse me. But one of the things that I'm seeing here that I want to sort of point out is that we have this, and this, and this. And that's the design. And, you know, then we've got, you know, this, which is really nice, that helps, you know, with the functionality of it. I would say project somebody's waist on there and see if that's going to be the result. That should be fine. You might want to replace this material or at least back it or frame it with something besides these posts. But one of the things that I'd like to see you do with this design, and we can go to the 2D stuff too if this is Shift and F, not Shift and A. Da-da-da-da-da. Yeah, it's going to be a little bit better. Is consider something that would be like, okay, yes, it's, you know, we're talking about magical energy and things like that, but could we change this so that, you know, these particular types of assets maybe are a little bit higher as opposed to this? So, you know, we're still working with like some type of base that acts as a matter of support. And then we've got something that would act as a type of lid to, you know, go ahead and pull these things out or extract these in some way. It would be great to see some type of manufactured lid, even if it's just like a simple type of hinge. Maybe it's something that you incorporate into this so that we have... Maybe it's curved to conform to the body, but then This actually has a little bit more of like a straight form to it. And then we've got some type of, it can be a simple hatch like this that we put some, here's an opportunity to create some, some really nice, beautiful type of hinges that would go on there, with some type of iconography that can help that. But that would, turn that back. That would be another one. It would also help provide some context to it, just a little bit of functionality. So the idea of asymmetrical balance, maybe we're not making this so much one and the same. We're changing that up. A little bit of some material back here, or some sort of like framework back here, and you're going down a path that's really cool in terms of like the idea of using these kind of ornamented things for this. No such thing as going halfway over a cliff if you start to create these things and they start to have like some type of, pattern that acts as a support device, ribbing and things like that. Go for it. Be elegant with this. It should look elegant, and the elegance of your shapes should sort of reinforce the idea of the magical qualities of this. In terms of, we've got these stone containers and things like that. There's the idea of, how the force field gets sort of controlled or emanated. And that, I think, is something that they're playing up in some of your imagery, which let me just, you've got some reference here that's kind of pulling on that, and I just want to bring this down into here. Something along these lines would be great. Just to have it kind of suspended. That doesn't really help explain some of the, again, that idea of like, somebody built this. Some race of people with the ability to build these things built this. And it's that idea of what we were talking about, kind of like in the Thor universe where, magic is a some combination of technology and mysticism and things like that. That's, super advanced, as opposed to just sort of doing like a fakeroo and just saying, well, they float, that type of thing. That's sort of like just a weak answer to, the question of functionality, that even in a magical type of universe, you can still explain it with some type of structure, to say that, the field emanates out of these core housings that are there, and these internal forms, and maybe these have sort of like, some type of shape pattern at the base of them that helps, tie into the shape motifs that are in here and in here. So that's something to think about as well. It's very central and it's very simple, and a belt would be great. I would probably suggest some type of showing some type of strap that would, come off of here that they might attach and then, strap onto their thigh or something like that. Along the lines of like a thigh holster, if it's like a backpack, there might be straps to it or something along those lines. That functionality, I think, would just help carry over the idea that the scale of it, that it can be carried by someone. I think that would be useful. And in terms of these shapes in here, think about the tiers as well. If you can have something that comes, if the profile looks like this, but then if it, kind of comes out like that, and maybe has some type of hard edge around the bottom, basically in here as it comes around. So maybe there's a soft edge right here, it rolls off. You're just thinking about this profile curve that would help create this. And going beyond something that would be just like a straight line with something embedded atop of it. Try to think of ways that this can be a little bit more elegant. And that's all in the design. That's all in just sitting there with Photoshop and drawing it out. You can go ahead and execute this stuff in Maya, but drawing it out first, I think, is going to be more helpful. In terms of, so, you know, photo reference and things like that, I think is going to be useful. In terms of your glass casings and things like that, think of it as something that has thickness. So you're going to want to have two sides to this because it's going to run a refract light. And if there's anything internal to this besides those base units along the sides, and that could sort of play into these side structures that I was referring to. But if there's any type of floating, energy or something that comes down from the sides that helps keep these, you know, stabilized or something along those lines, I think that would be interesting as well, because we have a big space in here, and whatever you put in here, that should be included to help with create a little bit more of that asymmetry, especially if it's something like a stone that might be, you know, something that's very raw and rough in its cut that is off to like this, or maybe if it's a couple of them and they're kind of like floating and stacked in some sort of stasis field. That's definitely something to think about in terms of any of magical elements that for a game asset that you want to create some type of polygonal. You know, this is where you get into the fun stuff of effects, and not just, I'm not talking about particles or anything like that. I'm talking about the idea of, you know, almost like strands of hair that are polygon types of ribbons, which can be created really easily with curves that end up having something mapped on them that acts as an alpha mapped type of effect, like a swirl or some type of plasma bloom or something along those lines. That's where this is, you know, the power and the functionality of this is going to play out, because it's not so much in the high tech terms of, like, you know, physical systems of, you know, hydraulics and electronics and things like that. So that's pretty much what I would, the depth that I would take this into now, to really get this stuff finalized, because you're on the right track. It's just that the results of the design are just kind of like, you know, you're not really diving into the design itself and trying to come up with more interesting shapes, with the exceptions of, you know, maybe like this pendant, which could be an alternate solution. I mean, I think that's probably the most interesting shape you have, simply for it's the keychain variation. If there's aspects of that you can incorporate into this, maybe it's a big pendant that also is, you know, fixed to a belt, and it has some sort of overall shape variation, so we don't just don't go, you know, like that. That it's kind of like, this is narrower up in here, still with all of the things that we talked about, but you've got that kind of cowling that comes over it, and, you know, maybe the glass is curved. There's something along those lines. Curved glass, like bell jars and things like that, always has an interesting aesthetic to it that incorporates a lot of that, because then the faceting can take place inside, and a lot of the, you know, any filigree work or any, you know, sort of, you know, almost like the bezel holding of the glass fixed to, you know, some ring that would be the power structure of it combined with that lid. That would be kind of cool. And being able to see through it from the bottom, that would be interesting as well. Think about, as you design this, you know, if about the motifs that you're using, you know, the shape patterns, do they mean anything? Is there something on the bottom that is a map of some insignia, you know, some type of icon that helps unlock something? Is it something that relates to your story? That kind of stuff is really going to help sell the design as well. So I'm thinking overall just a little bit more brainstorming and then executing in 3D, but then really starting to dive into the modeling process is what needs to happen here. Okay, if you have any questions, comments, suggestions, or anything like that, let me know. Let me move this off. I've just been taking everybody through a little bit of this process to get something created that will help you with, I think 100 is where we want to be. 1000 might be a little bit too much. 200 is going to be fine. Just that idea of what do we want to do here? Let's do that. Creating a sweep that would probably help this along a little bit more. And to be honest, we probably don't want to have anything like that. Let's get that in there as well. Should be okay. Select an edge, double click, right click, invert the selection to get the internal edges, soften all of those. If we need to, we can slide some of this stuff out. Sometimes I create these things a little bit too quickly, and the transitions need to be softened a little bit. Maybe do an edit edge flow on that, soften that out. Just trying to create a sweep so that when you just as I figured. Let's flip that edge, there we go. Something just, hopefully that has a little bit of elegance to it. We can assign a new material to this. Probably not a blend shader, sorry about that. That was my bad. Let's make this Lambert. Matte. And just make it white. Rotate this, hold J, boom, boom. Bring it in like that. And then just use like a two-panel layout and create a camera. And then go to your panel's perspective and pick that camera. And turn the grid off. Now you got something where you can sort of see this through that special camera that you just created, unique camera. And then you can we can set the resolution of this camera in our render settings. Use the Arnold renderer, go into our file name prefix, heart and concept, and then you can save it as like a JPEG. We need to set a resolution. I would usually set 2K if I was doing concepts just so I could paint on something in Photoshop. That should be fine for that, and then you could turn the resolution gate on so you could see what it's going to look like so you can frame it and get something. Last thing we need is a light, and that's going to be something that we manipulate in perspective. And that for that, we need to go to the Arnold tab and this first icon, creating some type of area light. Just need one for this type of thing. You can use other ones too. Maybe we just move it off like that. Something over the shoulder of the camera. And then for these lights, it's all a matter of intensity and exposure. Those are going to be the two big factors outside of the color, but I wouldn't bother with color right now. It's mostly just getting the shape down. You're going to have to open up the render, and we can go ahead and set this exposure to say like 20 and play this. Got the wrong camera, select that camera, back out, start to get the result that we want. It blows it out, and it's better to sort of overdrive it, because then you can dial it back in and just say, like, okay, well, what's 15 look like? Okay, 15 might be a bit much, but we only have the intensity at 1. And if I, you know, bring that intensity up, I might start to get at this, like, happy medium of a concept that's got a little bit of, you know, ambient light. We're bouncing stuff around. It's a sweep, so it's like a single color. It's just like a photo studio. And you can have a result. It's going to take a while to render this, just because I've got the recording going. But once it gets created, you can, you know, you can have something that's pretty interesting looking. I think I've also got it at full resolution, and we can bring this down to like 50%. It'll go a lot faster. You can even bring the test resolution down like 25% and get something that's pretty good. Maybe stop it, try it again. Looks like it's doing a little bit of a crop on me right now. That's fine, but at least we start to see what everything is going to look like. It looks like you've added a blend shader to this with some transparency, which is fine. I mean, that's going to help create something that you want. I would just say make sure that these things have two sides to them. Right now, this probably has one side, and glass has thickness. And that thickness is how you're going to get that refraction, especially if you use something like an AI surface shader. And what I would do to achieve that is a really straightforward result. We're just grabbing this edge. You know, and this is pretty low resolution. It's a good place to start, but it's not going to be. I would extrude these, go inward with them like that. And then let's see if it'll agree with me. Yep, and then bridge those together. And that will give us the thickness that we need. Probably needs to be, the UVs need to be straightened out. Forward a little bit. But with that, and if we change this to something along the lines of the standard surface shader, you can let me grab all these and soften them, and then grab these and harden them. Probably want to harden these as well. It just depends on how it ends up looking, but delete the history on that. I'd give this, you know, some type of name. We can go back to that sort of blue, go into the transmission, kind of kick that up 80%. Take a look at the attributes of this. I wouldn't get too finicky with this. This is something that you're just doing for concept work. Shift, Control, H, bring everything back. Open this back up. And let's go back to our test resolution, bring that to 50%. What else do we got to do? I got to... It's the beginning of it, so we start to get some more transparency. It needs to be changed because there's some things about the transmission that need to be adjusted as well, especially the depths. And you can see it's like it's updating. Scatter right now has no value to it, but you can get all kinds of more complex types of transmission of light through things. We can get into stuff like this. I would rather you get into this stuff in Substance later. Don't get too hung up on this stuff. It's mostly just to sort of show the development of your concept and to take it into Photoshop and do some paint overs and make some notes on it and do some indications, okay? So if you want to keep it limited to the Maya software, you can do that, or you can take it into here. But it'll at least give you the beginnings of things. So there's some shape language some compositional things, some balance between the top and the bottom, maybe the overall shape itself vertically, you know, looking at that keychain inspired by that. But I think this should give you a little bit of a, you know, a lane in which you can keep yourself to drive this concept a little bit further. And then as you work some things out in 2D, you know, get it working in 3D. Just create more visual interest for it, okay? If you have any questions, let me know. Thanks. George, hello, it's Patrick. Sorry I wasn't able to hold class on Monday. I'm going to schedule some time later in the week to sort of have a makeup class, but which isn't, no one's required to attend. I take it that this is probably the latest iteration of what you've been working on, which is really good. It's good effort. And it's based off of some designs that I'm seeing, I think, in here. And you've got a good sort of, even though it's, you know, sketched out kind of small and loose, we've got a little bit of a description of what's going on with some of this. And this looks like some inspiration. The problem is, there is no written description in your submission, and I need to, you know, even if it's, you're comfortable, you know, if you want to write it in a different language, or if I, you know, I don't know, don't want to assume that, you know, you might be able to speak five different languages. It's up to you. If there's any way that you want to submit it, that's fine by me. But I need to sort of understand your thoughts, and so that I can, you know, kind of work with you through some of the shape language and some of the way that you're presenting this. A lot of what I'm seeing looks good in terms of the functionality and some of the design. You know, wondering about where some of this is coming in, some of this is coming in. We got some shape breakdowns in there that need to be examined a little bit better, although that probably is just going to do better just like that. Instead of being, you know, something that we interpret like that. So I would probably, you know, a lot of this looks good. If you're interested in actually articulating this, we can talk about setting up some cell shading, or not cell shading, but some animation keyframes and things like that. But I get the sense that there's like this progression of like, okay, this is a device that is processing something for this, and we've got something that has this is a human limb, or at least the indication of it. I don't know. And we've got a device in here where this gets stored in here, and here's the device itself. You know, lots of modeling and lots of interesting solutions in all of this. In terms of what I think is working the best, this device has a little bit more planning in it, and it looks like with your render that's what you would like to include as well, which is, it's fine. I would probably just say power sources and readout displays and a little bit more backstory for me in terms of explaining it. That would be excellent. Because the more I see in terms of how you're explaining it to me, the better I can sort of get into those ideas and say, okay, these might be some solutions in terms of the functionality to help carry this idea across. And, you know, you're dealing with some really clean-looking technology. So, you know, the idea of culture and iconography and things like that might come in later in the text and types, things like that. But we can still get into kind of how this fluid gets in here, or whatever this is, how energy is, you know, brought into this device to power it, where that in the indicators of power and the instrumentation that help control this are located. Those would be big things. Shape language wise, your primary shape is, you know, it's kind of this there, like a crate, which is something I would hope that you would avoid, but you're breaking it up in a way that is interesting at the corners, especially with this type of articulation. So that's good. And that's kind of a saving grace for it, which is nice. Let me go into here, get that to there. In terms of this stuff, this is where you're going to need either some holding edges at the corners, or you're going to need some creases. And, this might be the type of thing. The smooth mesh preview in and of itself isn't going to do it. These are either going to have to be beveled in some way, if you're just using straight smooth mesh preview, which is looks like what you're using right now to create this, or we go into things. Let me create a set for this. Create sets. Quick select set. And just crease corner. You can do this for all of the edges that need to be creased. You can add it to the shelf too if you ever want to like activate it. I'm going to go back to it, but what I need to do is create a subdiv proxy for it, just so that. And once you delete the hist, you can delete history on the base objects of subdiv proxies. And we could just move this off to the side, 10 units. Although this looks like it's off. Yeah, freezing the transformations usually not the best thing, but at least now you have something like that where then you can go to select and quick select sets, crease corner, there it is. Can crease those and start to establish those sharper edge transitions. I've also got some what look to be some smooth edges that just need to be set up. The hard edges don't get inherited in here. And those are going to need to be established just with some extra topology. Because I've noticed that even as these get activated, they don't usually help. And this is just the linear interpolation is not going to be as good a result as this exponential one, which makes all of this stuff kind of like superfluous. So even though we've creased these edges, it looks like holding edges are going to be in order to help this along as well. And it might be something that's a simple result. Let me go into the multicut tool. Don't worry about that green material. I would say, where's, there's Lambert 1, just bring that back. But at least you're starting to get your corners under control. And they're going to need some, they're going to need more topology in there for those sharp transitions, just to be controlled a little bit better. Going ahead and doing something like this is kind of the aggressive answer, but I don't know, I could be adding a ton of stuff along the bottom. It needs to be very specific to a lot of these things, but the result gives you something better. Those pinches that you're seeing are probably, yeah, it's because of this stuff there and there and there. And again, it's probably carrying it over to edge loops where you might not want things, but at least it's cleaning up some of those sharp edge transitions. Now, if you want bevels of a certain thickness, a certain transition, the way that you've been developing it is going to be probably the best way to do it, which is just go in there to those edges and bevel them yourself. And that way it just guarantees that none of that stuff is even there. Because this is where the subdiv proxy is sort of like, okay, it can help you get so far, but the specific types of bevels that you're looking for might be something that you just want to create on your own. So a little bit of kind of background on that. I'm going to bring this whole thing back here for a second, because also please save Maya ASCII files, not Maya binary files. They're text-based. I can fix them if they get corrupted. I just prefer them. And make sure that you're deleting all your history when you submit things. So what do I want? I want you to sort of flesh this concept out a little bit more, but introduce to me some written form of your submission that explains this a little bit better. I'm getting some general indications of this, and some of this is really cool. But, you know, it's a really interesting concept. But I just need to understand more about what's going on here. I see a delivery system. I see something in here, but I don't see anything in terms of what you've submitted that helps me understand, you know, or explains, you know, what's going on here. You're looking in all the right places, I think. I would say if this is some type of biomedical thing, that you look a little bit more in that direction in terms of, you know, how this is introduced in games, but also just in the real world. I think that would be great as well. You know, industrially, you're creating some shape language that has some visual interest to it. You're creating the mechanisms that can be put in place, little ribbon cables that connect the stuff. I mean, interesting things. Not really sure about what's going on with this in terms of a grading, but yeah, I get it. That's good stuff, and it's going to look great. We just need to, if I have a little bit better idea of what's going on, you can, you know, explain a little bit more of the context to me. And I would just say what I was saying in class, which is the who, the what, the where, the when, and, you know, how or for what purpose, you know, that type of thing. If you want to look back at previous students, you know, Annabelle's and some of the students from the first video, I talk about the creation of a setup in Arnold to get some renders going in there. To use the AI surface shader for some of these things to get some, you know, some better looking surface attributes. That to me isn't as important, because it'll help you for some of the conceptual things to see how they're being lit and see how things are coming together. But I would just say answering more of those questions of that are presented in the first assignment, in terms of not just the written explanation, but typography, some of the small details, the functionality, and things like that. That would help a lot, okay? So with that, I would just say keep working. Excuse me. And when I see things that you could submit them in Module 2, because you can do multiple submissions in each assignment, and you can kind of fill me in on what's going on, and then you could start to make improvements on your concept and submit those as well. Like I said, I'm going to be posting something later today, which is Wednesday, to talk about either tomorrow or Friday, to have a makeup lecture. I'm just going to be talking a little bit about everybody's work, you know, on a cursory level, and then getting into some specific things with modeling and in here and in ZBrush with the development of assets, and you know, kind of help people with individual issues, and hopefully they pertain to everybody in some way. Plus, we can talk a little bit more about the pipeline. Okay. Thanks. Good work. Jordan, hi, it's Patrick. Excuse me. Just kind of rolling through these, trying to get you guys some feedback. I apologize for having to cancel class last Monday. I just was not able to get myself together. I will be later today, which is Wednesday, I'll be planning on creating some sort of makeup lecture for this late in the week. It'll be you know, just an no one's required to attend, but it's like just a makeup class session where I can work with people on their concepts, and, you know, we talk about the development of them and ways to sort of get things moving along. Let me take a look at some of this inspiration that you've got. Okay, going with something opens itself up like that. Some battery things to recover. That's an interesting kind of drop pod concept. Things along those lines. Okay, we'll go back to those. So it's a medical supply container magnetically locked into place. Open, the casing would unfold, vial would float between the poles. Three-sided pyramid form, less like it was human designed. Yeah, I mean, it's, this could be the kind of thing that would be one module within several different modules. Delivery system, maybe through some type of missile system or just even like a storage system that would be a larger container, and these would be the individual ones that people could carry. Yeah, that's fine. Do me a favor when you're submitting Maya scenes from here on out, save Maya ASCIIs for me. I just prefer them. They are more stable. They're bigger, not that much, but also I can edit them in a text editor because they're ASCII, they're not binary. So if you could do that, that would be awesome. Let's take a look at some of the stuff that we've got here. Let me get a two-panel layout going here and get a camera. I don't know if you have a camera already. Okay, you've got some lights in here. I'm going to hide these lights for now because you're doing a Maya software renders, and I tend to do Arnold renders because they look better. But to do that, I always recommend that you don't just use the perspective view, but create a camera in and of itself. Go to your panels and use the camera and set it up like this so that you can stage things as you need them. If you're willing to do paint overs in Photoshop or just adjustments, color things, those can be loose. I would go into the render settings. We're going to use Arnold. Can use a JPEG format. You can, do something like your last name, concept. That's what I would have been, kind of putting on everybody's work. You can use a name.number extension. So if you wanted to have three numbers out, it'll give you an example of what it looks like. 001, 002, that type of thing. So it'd be Johnson concept.001. And then we got to get into the aspect ratio, and I would just make this like a 2K square, close that out. And then with the resolution gate, you can get something that looks like that. So we get a square image, we get something that is nicely framed. We're not messing with the camera as we're messing with the perspective camera. So we have the thing that we work in, and then we have the thing that we present in. And that to me is, I think, the best route to get this stuff looking decent. Something along these lines, maybe we put it up here, a little bit of this, a little bit of this. Grab that, that's parallel to the picture plane, that'll give us maybe a little bit of an over-the-shoulder camera light, like that. And then we got to look at it, so we need the Arnold view, that's Annabelle's work that we were doing before. Let's go ahead and hit space. It'll probably turn out jet black because there's nothing to see because our lights don't have any exposure to them. So take it into the attribute editor. I'm going to stop the render for now. It sort of runs perpetually. And the first thing I like to do is crank the exposure up to something like 20 and take a look at what the results are. Usually very blown out. And then I start to dial it back down. There's 10, and we can start to see that 10 is working pretty good. We're probably, let me stop this, we're probably too close to the sweep, and that's why it's kind of gathering up against these things, and I would probably want to put them against a, so I'd move this away from them, because the whole point of the sweep is to try to get a blend between the floor and the ceiling, or the floor and the wall. And then I would grab that to that, extrude this out. Just need something along those lines. Probably don't need this to go out so much like that. But that should be fine too. Let's take a look at the results of this. Where'd my window go? I got a couple things going on here. So a little bit better, getting a little bit of, you know, gathered light in there that we can average out. It's a couple things we could do, but at least we're getting some shadows that are helping interpret this. And the lighting, let me do a test resolution here. Bring it down to 25%. Things will move a little bit faster. I can close the display settings. Kind of start to work this stuff a little bit more. Oh, come on. Hang on a second. It's just slowing down on me. Can't pick things in the window. So, let's see. Let's bring this. Might chug a little bit on me. That's okay. Yeah, so maybe we want a shadow, but maybe we want something that's just a little bit not going to hang off the composition side or anything like that. This is the kind of stuff that just, to be honest, I would probably stop the render really fast. Let's go ahead and detach that. Get rid of that. You go global with the extrusion and just go straight up like that. And then double click the outside, right click, and invert the selection. Just make sure that everything has been softened on the inside. Softened. And it cleans it up a little bit. The other thing that we can do is right click and assign a new material that is matte, and it also is white. Again, not perfect. It's not going to be just a flat thing, but that's not really important right now. Just seeing how this shape language is working itself out, I think, is going to be useful. What you're seeing in terms of the grain is like the sampling that's going on, and that can be changed in render settings in this window. If you open that up under display, there's actually, it's not under display, excuse me, it is it's in the render settings. I thought it was also in here, but I know that you can access it in here with these sampling levels. I would suggest that you maybe read up a little bit on the sampling levels. Take a look at some YouTube videos. They'll just talk about overall quality. This one is going to really help you the most overall. But you can see, like, if you don't have subsurface and things like that, you don't really need it. You know, you can lower these and raise certain things that you know you will need. That's basically the gist of it. But we're not going for finished stuff right now. And ultimately, you're going to be bringing this into Painter anyways to develop those texture sets. So this is more just to sort of get a decent looking render that helps, sort of express this with some better lighting of how things are going to look. I think this is a great idea. I think maybe a little bit more. The diamond pattern is fine. That doesn't bother me. I would probably say maybe some changes to the let's go ahead and hide this so we can just focus on these for now. And I can also go to show and hide. hide cameras and lights. Is to maybe think about how these things, you know, are being modeled. It's not necessary to make this all, you know, one object. Try to avoid that watertight stuff right now. That's not really important. Pieces, you know. We'll bring these things together. This is very clunky against something that's very elegant. And that's something that I would say, try to reconcile that shape language. Make this handle a little bit more elegant, and maybe even make the handle, let's use the Epic Pen for this. Have a little bit, maybe, almost like that. So it has a little bit more of a line that mimics this line. At the same time, these arms can have a little bit more of something that, you know, maybe has a line quality that's a little bit more elegant as well on the outside. It's a bit mechanical, right? So we got this type of aesthetic, which is very, you know, much based in the human real world, and then we got this that's, you know, much more something that's unique. I like this idea of breaking apart a cylinder and then sort of using these faceted forms. It almost takes on a like a plant-like type of design. And maybe if you're thinking about it, that like a tulip or some type of bud that opens up, you know, there's something there in terms of, like, you know, taking the organic and making it mechanical and also functional. That's a really interesting sort of approach to things with your design. But then having a canister in here that is still, you know, very pure and its cylindrical form and things like that's fine. I would just say primary shape breakdowns, refine those, get into those secondary shape breakdowns, and then start to think about language that runs along these things. We don't want to fudge this stuff. We want to make sure that you're, you know, doing maybe paint overs with the renders from Arnold, or you're just going in and doing some drawings in Photoshop. This is the kind of thing that drawing will help, just to get some of those line patterns of, like, okay, how are the shapes broken down along these things? Is it panels? Is it a material? Is it something that's kind of like a combination of the two? You know, a lot of this stuff and this. You know, and this can be something that help informs that whole process, this particular piece of art. You know, this, not that bad. It probably dwells more into the straight edged and more mechanical type of thing, even though we're still working with this type of, like, panel thing. I would just say that's, you know, a curved line with a rounded corner versus, like, a lot of straight edge stuff. That's something to consider, how you break these shapes apart in terms of the panels, in terms of venting and things like that. So those systems that you're implying, you know, that carry over through this concept, imply functionality. It's like, okay, if the functional sort of arms fit into here, which I would probably say, let's try to figure out a way that they insert into there a little bit better, as opposed to just a wheel. You know, try to integrate it with some sort of, you know, broken line. Boom, and then like that. How they fit into there, how these pieces fit. Maybe there's a little bit more of, like, maybe there's something to this where it, you know, this line, like I said, you know, this starts to, this is mirroring this sort of shape, and then this kind of comes around like this, as opposed to just a curve, and that way we can sort of incorporate something like this. Maybe there's something that comes outwards off of this that helps sort of fit this into it, into place. So there's some form that comes up like that. You know, and then maybe it comes around like that too. So it's just breaks off there. Just some type of housing for this arm. A piece that feels like it has a little bit more structure. We can talk about the shape breakdown of this as well as you're working into this concept. Generally, I think it's a good concept. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff that still needs to be worked out, but let's get it worked out. Let's try to get things fleshed out in terms of refining the big. If I could, let's get back into writing things here. So we're talking about the refinement of the large. Woo, hey, speaking of the large. How'd that happen? And then you've got medium shape breakdown, so that's good. But I think where we need to go now is into the small, into the very small or very fine, and start to make some explanations for that. And sometimes these things can relate to the systems, you know, in terms of the panels, in terms of the functionality of things. And where those, you know, what that might contain. And when you get up to this point here, I feel like this needs to have, you know, maybe if this had some type of sort of like setup here where these, you know, as in addition to sort of having a little bit more of like a line that went like that to that to that. Maybe even if they had some type of almost like wedge that went back over into there that helped cover this thing up so that it wasn't such an open space up there. Or if it was like you've got these kind of tongs that go over, that they meet at a seamless point so that we just don't see any of that stuff. Just help finish that sort of shape language up there to make it seam together a little bit. And, you know, this was working, but there's nothing that says, you know, you can change this if you want to. You can kind of break it off to something like a rounded straight line that maybe even has like some type of small piece that kind of tilts open. Some flap that kind of opens up, that type of thing. Those types of functional things I think would be good to sort of sort out and refine. Because right now there's cool things going on, but I think there's some things from a design point of view that you just integrate a little bit better. So with all that, I would just say keep working, keep refining this, keep the iterations coming. And if doing it in 3D is the only way you're going to do it, that's probably going to take you a little while. You know, try to get these things worked out in 2D, even as scribbly as they might be, or as quick as they might be. Because that way you can align is a quicker thing to do than modeling something and trying to get it to work symmetrically across, you know, three different pieces. That you then have to use the duplicate special, and then you go back and you're checking and things like that. Don't have that kind of time in terms of this, you know, the iteration of the concept phase. Just try to nail these things down based off of what you do have and refine them. And once we get that concept nailed down, then you can, you know, really dive into the development of this. Some of the small and very small things are things you're going to have to resolve as we work, but you know, they should be resolved by the time this high resolution thing is all done. Okay? So if you have any additional questions, just let me know. But I'll be announcing when we have another little replacement lecture, or at least class period, where I'll be around to help work with you guys later this week. Thanks.